This video is about the Veil of Sin and the Sustainer, but I think I've accidentally discovered one of the real-world influences of Piero, which could tell us the story of how Conria fell and how the Sustainer was corrupted. So let's start with him. We'll move on to the Sustainer and the Veil after I've explained his potential role, as it could be even more important than I realized. Pietro was an Italian man from the 13th century known as Pietro or Peter di Abano, otherwise known as Peter di Epona. Abano or Epona was the town or village he was from, according to different sources, and Epona is also a genus of moth. Just for reference, the name Pietro is related to Piero and Peter in that they all come from the Greek name Petrus, meaning rock. Let's call him Peter just so things don't get confusing with the whole Pietro, Piero pronunciations. Peter was an Italian philosopher, astrologer, and professor of medicine in the province of Padua, Italy. He traveled to Constantinople to start his studies, focusing on ancient Greece, and would later move to Paris, becoming a doctor in philosophy and medicine. He had an insatiable thirst for knowledge, which caused him to branch out into a number of esoteric and occult studies, including astrology and demonology. But he was also known for his deep knowledge of physics and astronomy. Even making improvements on the astronomy of the time, his skills were so great that they led to his introduction to all the popes of his time, and what seems to be access to their vast libraries. According to later researchers, he was the first to reference the Little or Lesser Key of Solomon, which contains the famous Ars Goetia that Genshin's writers use to name many of their gods. Even though he was well respected, this fame and attention was a double-edged sword for Peter. He became known as the greatest magician of his time, and rumors spread that he had acquired this knowledge from seven spirits, which were enclosed in crystal. He was also said to own the Philosopher's Stone and have any money he spent brought back to him by the devil. With the Inquisition of the Catholic Church hunting for heretics in those days, these rumors didn't go around for very long before Peter was accused of witchcraft and brought to trial. He was eventually found not guilty, but was later brought to trial again, this time accused of heresy as he denied the existence and influence of spirits and demons, instead believing that celestial bodies influence nature and human affairs. Luckily for him, he died before his second trial was over and they found him guilty. His friends then took his body to be buried in an unmarked grave, as the church wanted to burn it to send a message. Instead, they had to make do with a straw effigy of him. So he's a pretty interesting guy, being known as the greatest mage of his time and having an interest in the skies and the occult, just like Piero being the royal mage of Conria and telling Scaramouche about the skies over Teyvat being fake. But I haven't even gotten to the most interesting thing about Peter yet, a book attributed to him called the Heptameron. This book contained the ritual magical rites concerned with conjuring specific angels for the 7 days of the week. Though it's attributed to Peter, it was written anonymously, as anyone dumb enough to put their name on a work like that would be instantly executed by the Inquisition. Speaking of the Inquisition, I think that Celestia could represent them with their extreme measures of dropping nails onto nations and being the authority representing God in the game. But since we don't know much about Conria, there could have been an equivalent there as a mirror to the Inquisition, but instead of heresy, they may have punished those that studied the gods, as they were a nation strictly without or even against them, while it seems that Piero doesn't mind working under the Tsaritsa. If Piero was a genius as Peter was, and wrote a book on how to summon the gods to do his bidding, perhaps the sages used his work to summon a specific god or gods in order to gain access to the primordial one and potentially take the throne of heaven for themselves by tearing open the Veil of Sin. So let's move on to what I've discovered about that. The Veil of Sin was located in the Temple of Jerusalem, also known as the Temple of Solomon, and is described in the Book of Exodus as being made from blue, purple, and scarlet material, with fine twisted linen. It separated the rest of the temple from the Holy of Holies, the earthly dwelling place of God's presence. Only the high priest was permitted to pass beyond the veil once a year to atone for the sins of the people, kind of like the priests of Dragonspine and other ancient nations. When Jesus gave up his spirit on the cross, the veil was torn in two and God left the temple, never to dwell in a place made by human hands again. In some interpretations, Jesus was said to be the representation of the veil, and with him dying to atone for humanity's sins, it gave all people free access to God. There's a few things to unpack here, so let's start with the colors used for the veil. Blue, purple, and scarlet, a shade of red. These three colors are used to represent three important powers within Teyvat. Though we can't say for sure which power fits where, Daenslift's being blue, like the ley lines and Ermansul, would fit quite well with him being the bough keeper, the bough being the main branch of a tree. Child's cape, being purple, likely represents his connection to the abyss, or at least the foul legacy he learned from Skerk, as the purple color is what we see associated with the abyss in most cases. It seems to be a mixture of the blue and red powers, with it being purple and described as chaotic. The sustainer's cape being red though, that's probably the most interesting of the three. Red is the color we've seen associated with the deep abyss, like when we escaped from the chasm, Zhao's karma, and Ermin's corrupted eye, which could represent the void realm and the black serpent we've heard very little about. To me, this says that the sustainer has been corrupted by the black serpent, who I think is the embodiment or ruler of the void realm, and that the sustainer's original powers may have been golden, as we can briefly see in the intro cutscene. Gold seems to be the color of Celestia's power, and may represent the fine twisted linen from the Veil of Sin. The Sustainer is hinted at by Hoyoverse in an interview to have connections with the Herrscher of the Void, who was the evil personality that took over Kiana Kaslana's mind and wants to destroy humanity. They said it was for us to figure out the connections between the two, so let me give it a shot. The Herrscher taking over was symbolized through Kiana's eyes, being blue normally, and turning golden like the Sustainer's when the Herrscher's personality took over. Void is also known as space in the Goblet artifacts, so it could be that the Sustainer or the Serpent was the shade of space or the Void, similar to Istaroth being speculated to be the shade of time. So, with Jesus representing the veil of sin, and his death meaning that people would have access to God, it's possible that the sages Piero wanted to stop tried to use or even sacrifice whoever represents the child of the primordial one. The candidates I can think of so far being the travelers, the sustainer, Istaroth, or Paimon. We know that the twins were sent down to Teyvat in response to the summoning, which could mean a few things. Either the sages of Khaenri'ah summoned the travelers as a way to get access to the primordial one, or the serpent I suspect was possessing King Ermin wanted to free its original body from the void realm, and may have succeeded, as I think Ashikai pointed out in an older video that this symbol could represent the three realms, with one of them being broken. Alternatively, the sages summoned someone else, and the twins were sent down to prevent the veil from being torn, but somehow forgot their mission, or even agreed with the plan of the sages, as it seems they lived in Khaenri'ah with Piero and Daenslift for a while. If the sages summoned the sustainer, but failed to contain her and she broke free, this could have caused her to go all out against the nation as an act of revenge. Especially if whatever they did was the cause of her becoming corrupted, and why she's fading away, possibly meaning that the serpent took over her body for some time, as the Herrscher of the Void did with Kiana. This may have been inspired by the story of King Solomon and the demon Asmodeus, with Solomon tricking Asmodeus into being chained up and used for his knowledge on secret matters. Asmodeus would later trick Solomon into freeing him and promptly threw him a great distance away from his palace in revenge. If the twins were summoned to be sacrificed or used to tear the veil of sin, I have an idea about what could have happened that's a bit speculative but could explain a few things. Let's say that after arriving in Conria, our twin agreed to be sacrificed or possessed by the serpent to free humanity from Celestia's rule, but either Pierrot or Dainsleif didn't agree with this method and found a way to interrupt the ritual or revive them against their wishes, maybe even making a deal with the serpent and helping it to possess the Sustainer instead. This would explain why our twin calls Dainsleif their enemy and blames him for the destruction of Conria, as well as Dainsleif's constellation being a serpent. To explain this properly, I'll briefly summarize the primordial snake Anunke from Orphic mythology, who I think the Black Serpent is partly based on. She was the sister and consort of the god of time Kronos. In the form of serpents, they crushed the primal egg of creation in order to create the ordered universe, and Farnes, the speculated name of the primordial one, was born from it. Anunke was the most powerful dictator of fate, and was depicted holding a spindle, representing her weaving the threads of fate on her loom with it. Prometheus tells us in the story Prometheus Bound that even Zeus has less power than Anunke, as he can't escape fate. Dainsleif's constellation is named Serpent Ring, or Ouroboros, a mythological snake described as imaginary and ancient in Enchonomia. This could be the name they've decided to use for the Black Serpent, as in Gnosticism, Ouroboros symbolized eternity and the soul of the world, possibly hinting at the serpent's connection to the primordial one. I think that this symbol that's come to be known as Solomon's Knot may instead represent the infinity of Ouroboros and its rule, before being cast into the void realm by the current rulers. In Vera's Melancholy, it's stated that having powers over time does little to stop the power of fate, potentially meaning that Istaroth's powers over time are of a lower rank than whoever has control of fate. Since we don't know much about the Shades, it's possible that there was a leader or most powerful among them who controlled fate, but is more likely the power of the Primordial One, or even what the Primordial One was running away from before hiding in Teyvat. We hear of the Loom of Fate from Dainsleif telling us about the Abyss Order operation, and he tells us that if we defeat him and rescue her, then the threads of all fate will be ours to reweave, hinting that the Loom of Fate is a device we can operate or a power we can take. If this is true, then it could be that the Black Serpent Ouroboros had its Loom of Fate stolen by whoever now rules Celestia before being cast down into the Abyss or Void Realm. As for the identity of the serpent, it could be the corrupted form of the Shade of Space or Void, Istaroth, Ermin, the Primordial One, or the embodiment of the star-devouring darkness, as in Honkai Star Rail, there's an Aeon called Ouroboros that is known as a devourer of worlds. Usurping the earlier heavenly rulers is a common trope in many mythologies around the world, the most famous version being Zeus and the gods overthrowing the Titans and banishing them to Tartarus, the lowest level of the underworld, and the God King is described in the legend of the Shattered Halberd as being surrounded by thunder and wind, a lot like Zeus, potentially meaning that the current ruler of the gods defeated his creator and banished them to the lowest level of the Abyss, which could be the Void Realm. Oh, one last thing I couldn't fit into the video but wanted to share. The transformation of people into Abyss Mages and Heralds may be based on the occult society of Thelema, where practitioners were tasked with crossing the Abyss without being tempted by Coronzon, the demon of dispersion and manifestation of the Abyss, that tried to trap and prevent them from reaching the other side. If they made it across, they would be reborn from the goddess Babylon and achieve Gnosis, becoming a babe of the Abyss. Just to keep things concise, Babylon most closely relates to Istaroth and is said to keep the demon Coronzon in check, which could be why our Istaroth seems to have left the heavens to dwell on the earth and even beneath it, like Enchonomia. The ones who successfully cross the abyss and were reborn are likely the heralds and lectors, while the ones who failed are probably abyss mages. So what do you think? Are the connections I've made likely, or do you have your own ideas that would fit better into the story? I'd love to hear your thoughts. If you've made it to the end of the video, thank you very much for watching. I hope you enjoyed our little adventure down the rabbit hole as much as I did. If you did, consider leaving a like, subscribing, and leaving a comment to let me know. This got really complicated and took a lot of revisions to make sense with all the topics covered, so if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them in the comments. Okay, that's really it now. Good luck on your wishes, and I hope you have a great day.